So welcome. So we have before us exemplars, excellent leaders, mayors of great cities. And I want to begin really by asking you, Mayor Wangard of Stockholm, to talk a little bit about Stockholm in the context of the New York proposal, the idea of inclusive growth. What's going on? What are you doing to promote inclusive growth in Stockholm?
Thank you. And I'm really happy being here. Thank you for the invitation. And I would like to talk a little bit about what I'm doing as a mayor in Stockholm, and how we work against social exclusion. And the most important challenges of our time is about social exclusion. And keeping people from achieving their best is the great waste of resources. We need to take care of people. We need to really focus on get to education, got the skills we heard about, and always implement our good work. Cooperation between cities, I really see that's a key in the future.
Thank you very much. And Mayor, please, I want to ask you, Mayor Altamirano, you have this affiliation with Harvard. You clearly are very embedded in the idea of urban planning and urban design. For you, your city won a big award for its city plan that you led. Tell us a little bit about what was unique about it and why did you win this award?
Yeah, well, first of all, I want to thank you for inviting me and inviting all these beautiful people to these gatherings.
They are beautiful, aren't they?
Yes,
yeah, I agree.
I'm going to speak in Spanish from now, so I can express myself in a better way, since you have all devices for translation.
Cities in Latin America, and this may be a reality in different continents, have not declared themselves as segregationist cities. These countries to which they belong do not state themselves as such, and nevertheless, we have designed a urban fabric that, in fact, segregates population into different categories and groups, making life and cohabitation complex, but also generating profits or winners and losers within the same city. When we had the opportunity to think about what kind of city we would want to have, we decided to see this challenge in five dimensions. The first one, based on the question why in cities and nature are considered antagonists. In other words, why until today we consider that life in the city should not include biodiversity, rather reject it, to put it outside, marginalize it. The next dimension has to do with infrastructure. And there we asked ourselves then, things like, do we want a city that will admit that biodiversity? In other words, for biodiversity to be accessible to the entire population and for it not to be an antagonist of nature, we also needed to redesign infrastructure in such a way that paradigms would change. It was no longer to try to bring the drop that falls most quickly to the river, but rather to leave the drop where it falls. The third dimension has to do with habitat, the way in which we organize people and things in the territory, and in what way those persons and things are going to interact. I'm talking, for example, about people without jobs. The less distance there is between in the house of somebody with low income in his job, greater possibilities of savings he will have. He will spend less in transportation, and he will then have greater profit based on his income. The fourth dimension is cohabitation, a little bit what the mayor of New York was saying. What makes a person a member of a community? We continue designing cities on the basis of giving the privilege of being at the top of that pyramid to the owners of the land. We will continue excluding women. In the case of Costa Rica, 90% of owners of a lot of a space, physical space, are men, males, same as the owners of enterprises. And the fifth dimension is productivity. In other words, how do we go from having cities that are consumption units, consumption markets, into producers of energy and food? Those are the five dimensions that where we see the possibility of developing territories, cities, and aside from that, allows us to ask these key questions and to base our proposal towards an inclusive city.
Mayor Javier Gonzalez, Santa Fe, New Mexico is one of four majority-minority states. And in fact, there are some unique cultural assets that really define Santa Fe. Talk a little bit about how you have used the cultural assets, the community assets of Santa Fe to make the city more inclusive and a growth trajectory that has been more inclusive.
Thank you. It's true, for more than 400 years, Santa Fe has been this collision of cultures that has turned it into this incredibly beautiful place where we have high-quality cultural institutions, whether it's the Santa Fe Opera, the New Mexico Museum System, the Georgia O'Keeffe, all the way to the culinaries. Santa Fe's cultural creativity really thrives. The challenge is there's a disconnect between that cultural richness and many people in our community. 20% of the people in Santa Fe are classified as living in poverty. More than 40% of our families are literally a paycheck away from being homeless. 25% of our children are classified as being persistently hungry. So what we did is we embarked on a cultural roadmap. We said we don't want to develop a cultural plan for the cultural institutions to thrive into the future because they're doing that very well. The idea of the cultural roadmap is how do you connect the community with these incredible cultural institutions that people from around the world are coming to see and experience. And so that required us to break down silos and barriers. It required us to go to these incredible cultural institutions and say, as part of your presence in Santa Fe, our deal with you is that we're going to continue to maintain a city of high quality, but we need you to invest in the people of our community. We need you to make sure that every child in Santa Fe has a meaningful access to an art program. So the Santa Fe Opera is, for the first time ever, investing in early childhood programs. We also said that we wanted the cultural institutions to participate in this cultural roadmap, not so much in ways that they can get more funding and thrive, but in ways that they can go into other parts of the community that are disconnected from them and find out what will it take for a Santa Fe family to walk through a museum door, for them to learn about Georgia O'Keeffe, or to go to a Santa Fe Opera. And what can we do to begin to pull the community together in ways that are meaningful? There's no doubt that with the presence of art in Santa Fe, we have a key asset to be able to help be a city of inclusivity, but there's a disconnect. And what we have to do is figure out a way to pull it together. This cultural roadmapping process is not just about making sure that Santa Fe continues to be a global leader in cultural richness, but that we're also a global leader in how we are able to create an inclusive environment for people to live and work in our community.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Mayor Malik of Tevragh-Zeina in Mauritania, welcome. Merci. Would you please talk about...
You're welcome.
...challenges that you face? Since you've been mayor, 2001, you were named mayor. What's the biggest lesson that you've learned, and what's the biggest challenge that you faced?
Thank you. Well, welcome to everyone. You're all champions. I'm delighted that for the first time you've respected parity, because it's the first time we have two women and two men on the panel, and that's important.
We're all about gender equity, so we have rules about this if it's in this building.
So now, before I go back to your question, I must set the stage. I must remind you that I come from the African continent with its own specificity. I come from a country where the Sahara is next to the Sahel. I come from a country that has experienced repeated droughts, which has led to the migration of the population from the rural areas to the urban centers. I come from a city where the desert meets the ocean. That is another challenge. This migration, which we call rural exodus, has meant there has been an exponential anarchical growth of the city, which has led to various challenges. Poverty, dropouts from school, because in my town there are two segments of the population with pockets of poverty next to pockets of great wealth. Every community is sending the richest children to paying private schools, whereas the poor send their children to public schools with lesser quality, because unfortunately, the same teachers who teach in the public schools are paid a second time in the private schools. And this has an impact on the quality of teaching in the public schools. With this quality, there's another loss. Our town wanted to remedy this school dropout problem, and we wanted to force the parents to send their kids to school, but allowing them to have an access to the labor force. Their children were unable to have small jobs. So our town remedied this by allowing certain families — we couldn't cover all the families because of a lack of resources — certain families were given the resources for these kids to have some revenue. We realized that with quality, the kids wouldn't go beyond primary school. The municipality took some steps to give remedial courses to those children, to the most underprivileged children, so that they could improve their knowledge and go on to junior high school and get beyond elementary school. Last year, and the impact was significant. Only 3 out of 100 students were held back. So this impact has been substantial. The major challenge has been education. We had to deal with this issue with substantial measures. Another challenge is health, because as I said, there's poverty. There's no health coverage, but the only people who have coverage are government officials. And the rest of the population lives in a precarious situation. Our town took some measures by setting up social dossiers. Those people who participated in the survey and who are listed as being indigent will now have an indigent card, which will allow them to receive care in certified hospitals at preferential rates, but only for indigenous people. We realized that the people who are most underprivileged didn't have the possibility of getting operation. And so the community has come up with vouchers for blood donations. With all the segments of the population, we have now neighborhood leaders, we have neighborhood community committees, and we organized young people. We even have volunteers. When people saw that these actions were addressed at the most underprivileged and that these actions had an impact, we even got volunteers who came spontaneously to sign up to support our town in these measures. I must say that I very early on decided to do two things. And the first of these, and this was a way of reducing inequality. Since 2001, as you pointed out, I've been mayor for 15 years. For 15 years, my door has been opened. Free access to anyone. No distinction between rich and poor. Everyone has access to the mayor directly. My second measure, which I continue to follow, is that everything done in the town is done in a participatory fashion. If something needs to be prepared, all segments of the population are invited to participate. We're democratic in that. And it's a majority that decides on the decision that's adopted. And there's another point that I feel very strongly about it. It's the environmental challenge. We're threatened by the advance of the desert and also of the water. And this has an effect on the most underprivileged, because when there are floods, the poorest have one foot in the water. It's not the other people who live in their beautiful villas. I'm giving you if I were to give you a photograph of my city, you'd see that there's some very precarious housing next to beautiful villas. So you don't need a microscope to see the inequality. We have many challenges to face. Unfortunately, we lack resources. But I think that'll be the second segment of our debate.
So I'd like you to just speak to what this kind of a platform, the OECD and the New York proposal for inclusive growth in cities, what does it provide you as a mayor? What's the value of it, and how will you be able to use it to actually advance inclusive growth strategies and policies in your city? Let's start with Stockholm.
Yes, this is really important to get together and listen to other cities and other mayors' challenges in the day-to-day work, because for Stockholm, for example, we are a pretty good example, but we can still see in the OECD ranking that we miss some economic growth depending on unequal society. So we need to get better. And one of the first thing I did as a mayor was to have a commission, socially sustainable, Commission for a Socially Sustainable Stockholm, and that leads me to take more better political decision to get a more sustainable Stockholm.
So the commission process made it possible for you to take more political risk?
Yes, because the commission collect information from the academic world and from our history and the geographic and how it looks like, things that we have heard about today. And then I can go further and make as much as correct political decision as possible.
well, but we have this sense, at least we Americans, that, you know, the Swedish have it all figured out. and that it's just this rather magical place, yes. Stockholm.
Yeah, we have a system.
and I'd love for you to, but it sounds like there are challenges even in Stockholm.
Oh. Yes, we have challenges because we want to keep up the good work and always, we like being best in class. Sorry.
Well, nothing to apologize for. Mayor Altamirano, for you, how are you going to use this? What's the power of this for you?
Bueno, a mí me parece.
Very well. I think that having been assigned to be champions of this campaign allows to have a louder voice, a better voice about inequality, which have many faces in our cities. This also allows us to have a distinctive policy in terms of the policies of the country. In other words, today, during the conversation that we are having, we've seen that we are talking about our relationship with the country. Countries, national governments usually tend to believe that relationships with the governments of the cities are a relationship to your subordinate and not to your with a subsidiary. The fact that the OECD has taken a look at cities allows the cities to claim that equality, claim our place among a government which basically is the smallest expression of governance with the ability to resolve problems in the field. That's, in fact, the advantage that we've acquired, that we are now recognized as this smallest unit which is able to resolve problems and claim for the problem and the solution to stay and be applied among us in the city, in regional areas, and also, eventually, the country could learn from the solutions that cities have come up with for people. Because the five points that I mentioned earlier only make sense if the center of public policy is people, human beings, things that they need, and the place where they live. In other words, place matters because the place should be like an elevator. Each day we press a button, and each day we get higher rather than lower, although it's very common, especially in the south of the world. In the south, it's common that the elevator would take us down. People have better quality of life in their private space than in their public space, which is not necessarily a fatality, which we can change that. I think another important thing is that I'm here representing the smallest city, probably, among the ones that have been invited. And I'm sharing with you a forum with the mayor of New York, which is the mayor. So this brings me to something that's very encouraging for the OECD and the Ford Foundation, because when we govern small or medium cities, the intelligence that we use, we gather from big cities most of the times that you can't apply it to a small or medium city. And as a matter of fact, it is in small or medium cities in which most people live. In other words, it's true that today cities have, well, the world, 60% of the world population lives in city, but 80% of people who live in cities live in small or medium cities. So I believe now we have the opportunity to generate an exchange in intelligence between small and medium cities from the fact that the OECD has recognized the value of cities because they're majority, the small and medium cities. They're not just the majority in numbers, but these are the cities that the most more people live in if you put them together. Pero cómo se utiliza el conocimiento de las pequeñas ciudades.
And are you confident that in Costa Rica you will be able to do this?
Yes. Nosotros lo que creemos.
Well, we believe we're developing tools and methodologies which were normally given by the government to the cities. We're turning this into our own methodologies and or instruments. We are developing an atlas of the, which we call the Atlas of the Real Experience of the Citizens, which allows us to review the quality of the grain, so to speak, the quality of the elevator I was talking about. In other words, what's the quality of life 50 meters around where people live? People live, and that's the center of their lives, and the quality of life should be great, but it isn't. So in order to govern these 50 meters around where people live is information, and this is objective information so that we can put that into the map, and the map can then be used to generate a dynamic that would propose public policies from the side of the demand and not just the side of the supply. Then we would have the ability to develop these instruments and methodology, which in my opinion should be taken from city to city, exchanged from city to city, to a reasonable scale with most cities in the world.
Salas, you are the only American mayor on this panel. And we Americans can be quite parochial in mm-hmm. our point of view. And so what is a proposal from some body in Paris on cities got to do with what an American mayor needs to do in his own community, because oftentimes you will find American policymakers very resistant to taking directives or even advice from institutions all around the world, particularly some European institution called the OECD.
Well, let me just say first, why this is important for people like myself is that we only know what we know when we come into office. Unless we're given vehicles to be able to expand our mind and our capacity to solve our most complex problems, we're just going to take what we know to try and solve the problems that exist every day. And so I think the Ford Foundation, OECD, by giving real commitments into exploring how to develop frameworks for becoming cities of inclusive is key. I also think partnering, I'm not just saying this for my friend Clarence Anthony, but partnering with key national organizations like the National League of Cities, National Association of Counties, the Conference of Mayors, become great partnerships for the Ford to be able to expand the knowledge base and the knowledge capital so that we can begin to develop programs and policies at the local level. Why Paris matters, or Stockholm or any other city, is because the common thread that we have are people. People in different cultures, or people where there are subsets of cultures that make up a city and the fabric of it. And I think that one thing that is present, at least when it comes to mayors, is that there is a common thread that unites us globally. And that is that not only do we love our cities and do we want to see them excel and thrive, we recognize that unless we act, unless we bring forward the best solutions possible to address the problems in a timely manner, our cities are going to fall further behind. So Paris opening up its knowledge base, or Stockholm, or any of the others, to American mayors is incredibly a great advantage. And I think Mayor de Blasio said earlier, there is so much innovation and creativity that has come out of Europe because they've been able to be outside of that parochial mindset of we're going to do things today like we've done them over the last 40 years because it's too hard to change the cultural institutions. So this idea of being able to forge new pathways and achieving real results is a great example for us to look towards.
Because at the end of the day, what matters is results. And
what matters is results, improving the quality of life of our citizens, overcoming the complex problems that climate presents, that poverty presents to us, and really becoming a city that we all can feel very proud of leading. And I don't think any single mayor that comes into office comes in with the entire knowledge capital to solve the problems. And they don't necessarily have the professionals around them. So being able to leverage relationships in a global sphere and foundation support are key to bringing resources right to the front helm so we can begin to develop policy to affect our communities.
Mm-hmm. Great. Mayor Malik, for you, is this the kind of proposal that will allow you to have impact back in your home city? How will you use this proposal, Madam Mayor, for impact?
Well, firstly, this proposal needs to be looked at under different angles. The first angle is how are we as leaders, are we going to carry the values that are embedded in this proposal? In Africa, you always have to look things straight up, because we have already enough problems on our continent, which means that we have a prerequisite to any development, and it is called decentralization. And that's not very developed in our country, in our culture. So necessarily, we need to do a good advocacy work with our leaders, and with our various partners, so that the competencies, the skills at City Hall, are supported by enough resources, and that's not often the case, particularly in Africa. We also need to take into account the support of our partners and the help of our partners, the various initiatives that they are called to lead. But we also need to have a rich exchange and discussion and dialogue between the various cities of the world. It's very important to share our experiences between the various cities of the world while taking into account that, we're all different. We have our own specificities. We absolutely need that the roadmap that will be drafted take into account the specificities of the various cities, the specificities of the various continents. It needs to take into account the most serious issues at the bottom of things, because I'm a person that believes, and I'm not only one, that the development is firstly local before it's anything else. And to have local development, first you need to have a number of conditions that need to be met, and this proposal of New York, in terms of its implementation, should take that also into account. I also think that outside of the issue of local development, we believe that we talk mostly about cities, but the SDGs are only dedicated to cities. But no, they concern everyone. And the new approach, the option that has been selected, and the issue of access should be, pushed by the people themselves, firstly. So we need to combine our efforts. We need to get the support of our partners. We need the cities to share their experience. We need that the national government take all of that into account, as I mentioned earlier. So when you have a global dynamic, I think that, and if we have that, I think the proposal of New York will have a huge impact on the ground.
A few minutes for questions, and as I look out into this audience, I see some pretty remarkable people, leaders of philanthropy, leaders of knowledge and evidence for cities, philanthropists at the global level, city council people from New York City, and all sorts of interesting characters. So I think we've got time to entertain. The mayors are happy to entertain questions from some of you interesting characters. Yes, sir, starting with you.
Tony Vasquez, the mayor of Santa Monica, California. You know, as I look at this inclusive, you know, as we're talking about inclusiveness, and I wanted to ask actually the mayor before he left New York, as he's moving forward with the affordable housing piece, I was wondering if he included an inclusionary housing piece as part of it, because I think that's what's real key. In Santa Monica, we passed, the goal is 30% of new construction of housing be 30% affordable. And as we talk about, you know, being inclusive, if we don't do that, I think we're missing the boat. And at the end of the day, this gap that we keep hearing about is only going to grow further and further. I mean, in Santa Monica, one of our toughest parts is to try to make sure that the young new millennium can actually afford to live in our city. And I'm sure New York is experiencing the same thing. And you probably are all in your respective cities doing the same thing. And I was wondering if anybody's looked at that kind of a policy.
That's a great point. And this is something that we didn't mention, but this, be careful what you wish for. So gentrification, what happens in a city like Santa Monica, which at one point was a very affordable city, and now you have to really fight because it's such a beautiful place. Brad Lander, you are here in New York City, and I think the mayor of Santa Monica asked a question that you might be able to address about the policy here, as you were, I'm not putting you on the spot, am I, Brad?
No. First, I'll say it was maybe 18 months ago right here that we had the conference about inclusionary housing and brought people together from around the country to really dig in on the details. I mean, the short answer is yes, the policy that the mayor was referring to is a requirement that in all neighborhoods that we increase the density of or where new development occurs, developers must include low and moderate income units along with market rate units to achieve those kind of inclusive neighborhoods at a range of income. So that's exactly the plan. The details are challenging, and that's why it's been so valuable, actually, to have a network from around the country and around the world that Ford has helped support. As long as I have the mic, can I ask the mayors a question? I want to ask about the relationship between your cities and your national government in achieving your goals. You know, it strikes me right here. On the one hand, it's wonderful to have cities innovate and lead. On the other hand, in this country, it's very difficult to get housing for the lowest income people without the Section 8 housing choice vouchers or to maintain our public housing without the historic investment that we've had. And it seems like, at least in the current debate that we're having in this country, in the presidential debate, even though there's some dialogue about inequality, there's relatively little about cities. You know, what's the horrific thing that's happening in Flint at least has focused some attention on the need for thoughtful attention to inclusive growth. But I feel like there's a disconnect between what our mayors are doing and what the national governments are doing. How can we use this process to help change that?
So, Sweden.
Yes, I can start. I can start with the first question. We don't have social housing at all. We have public housing and approximately 50% public housing, rental apartment, and 50% on the private market. But we have a queue. It's a lot of people wants to move into Stockholm, and it's affordable, but we need to build more apartments.
And where are the revenue generated for this? Does this come from the national government in part, or is it fully funded by the municipal government?
It's fully funded from our public companies. We have three public companies that build public apartments, and we have also investments from the private companies. So it's nothing we do from the municipal's taxes. And we have our own taxes, so we have our own budget and our own income. And from the national government, I always want to have more, but as the city of Stockholm, we are the one who's paying to the national government so they can make some difference in other sides of our country. They need the money.
Please.
I would like to answer the second question.
The only thing that's more difficult, or rather, the thing that's much more complicated than to manage your bureaucracy is to coordinate two bureaucracies. So if one of the bureaucracies is the national government, then we have the problem I just mentioned. At least we have this in countries that have the Napoleonic law, the Roman law. Because the laws are so complicated, it's difficult to reconcile the differences that come up. You know, when you think about the needs of the people. In other words, I do agree with Angel. We should just have skills as the criteria. Regulations should be able to adapt to the possibilities of or capacity to solve a problem that the local government have, which who's closer to the people. But in countries that have Roman law, Napoleon law, it's difficult to change regulations. So we're led to believe that it's easier to change reality than to change the law, which plays against us always. It allows the relationship between the national and city governments be always subordinate to and rather than equal. It's really complicated in our environment to get out of that situation. But there are three ways of achieving this. First, you can wait for the national government to give you capacity or skills. That happens very seldomly. Or municipalities could take charge or get in shape and get more muscle, which also happens, you know, just like when you go to the gym. It works if you keep going, but if you don't, then you fall apart. Or else you could radicalize the city. In other words, give the people the possibility to decide on public policy by using new technology and new governance methodology so that there would be pressure local government so we could get more ability to regulate and so self-regulate and so on.
Inclusionary zoning ordinance for longer than 20 years, 30% is a requirement for new development. We led the country in developing the living wage ordinance. We'll be at $15 by 2020. But what happened is everyone loved the idea of inclusionary zoning, just not in their neighborhoods. And so what happened was that the developments that took place started taking place on the south side of Santa Fe, which allowed for affordable housing to go up on the books, if you will, or access to housing, but it began to segregate the community and separate it. So what we are in Santa Fe today is a place where you have neighborhoods of high wealth. That's the historic district, the place that people fall in love with. And then you have the location where that one in five children or one in five families are in poverty, one in four children are hungry. And that's the south side where the new development took place that required the inclusionary zoning. So I think part of the challenge for all of us when we want to take on an inclusionary zoning ordinance, it really has to be not only inclusive in the development, but that has to be equitable in the city, which is what you guys are driving so hard now. I wish we would have known this 20 years ago, so that we understood as we developed this ordinance, it just wasn't about what was happening inside a development. It was about its relationship to the community in ways that would keep it together as opposed to separating it. So I think that's a key lesson that we've learned.
Other questions? Yes, sir.
Yes, good afternoon. My name is Nico. I'm the Executive Director of People for Global Transformation. And my question relates to the practice of leadership. One of the points which resonated with me from Mayor de Blasio's speech was that it said, you need to set a goal, even if it's uncomfortable, because this is what sets people into motion towards action. The goal of a pledge, of the New York pledge, is precisely to gather partner and give confidence to exposed political leaders who are accountable and to prod them to doing that. I think it was the Paris pledge for climate change was a success because of that. CO2 emission is a yardstick that we can all agree with. As far as inclusion is concerned, it's a bit more diverse. And from the mayor's perspective, how comfortable are you or are ready are you to move towards setting up quantitative goals that could set an action movement into motion?
How do you all feel about quantitative goals? There's a big risk there for you as
yes.
a mayor.
Yeah,
please, who wants to go? Well, who wants to take that one on?
Look, I would just say if you want to act, you have to define where you're going to go. And I think that does require leadership, right? And so in my own community, while we have low unemployment, we have high underemployment. So when we set a goal about fully employing our community at wages that are greater than the average wage over the last 5 years, everyone starts scratching their head and wondering how are we gonna get there? But it requires more than just a mayor to say it. It requires buy-in by the entire community. So I think that if you want to achieve something, if you really want to make sure, if you're serious about moving your community forward, you have to be held accountable. And the only way you can be held accountable is if you set outcomes that are ambitious but also achievable and ways that have more than just yourself buying into it. I think a lot of times you have mayors that will step up and say, here's where we're going, and they're kind of the lone person that's going out there. Having the capacity to build a broad array of coalition participation in defining the outcomes and getting there is key.
It's important too for measurement methodologies consider the particularities of territorial governments. In other words, traditional statistics for tends to review government actions into silos, that is, by partial realities, and so that together they create a fictitious vision of the reality that the citizen lives and that it is very present in the eyes of the local governments. I think that mayors, we should be ready to determine proposals and to quantify them, but also to innovate in the way in which we measure them in such a way that this measurement has a territorial correlative, because our characteristic is to be territorial governments, not sectorial governments. And the majority of statistics that the academy gives us or the NGOs or the world bureaucracy at the national level too are methodologies for sectorial measurements that tend to divide reality into silos. We would have to break that down in some way.
Schematically, I think that when you have a good dosis of leadership, when you are sufficiently committed, when you have good visibility, when you've set your objectives clearly, but above all, when this is a joint movement, there's no reason for this to fail.
Really important and have a really engaged leadership to make it happen. And we have a vision for Stockholm.
Que hemos integrado una ciudad para 2004 y a fin de cuentas
sustainability, it will be a climate smart city and a democratically sustainable city, and it's high goals, but it's it makes my day-to-day work easier because then I always struggling to reach the goals, so it's really important.
When you ran for mayor, did you run on this platform? Did you promise that you were going to make Stockholm these things and you would be accountable?
Yeah, when you run for election, you need to have the goals really clear and understandable for the citizens. Mm-hmm. And then they are interested in goals within 4 years period. So then it's like easier goals and also achievable in 4 years period.
I was just going to add that it's for the mayors in America, it's still highly political, and if you're going to step out, be ready to get shot and just have to go through the wounds.
So what do you do when a mayor gets shot? I mean, not literally.
You have to plan and prepare before you speak so that you're able to respond to the critics that will most inevitably come out and try and derail or move your plan in a different path.
Yes, Brian.
I'm Brian Gallagher, CEO of United Way Worldwide, and maybe it dovetails on this leadership question, and that's, to me, around messaging. So it seems like inclusiveness, for some, if it's have and have-nots, the haves believe that they have to give up something for others to get something. Mm-hmm. And if it's about poverty, then it's, you know, it's that the language itself is exclusionary. And I wonder what you've learned about messaging in terms of how to frame this discussion where those that might feel like they're going to give something up in order to create common good don't become vocal critics. Mm-hmm. In other words, how do you create a narrative that is inclusive in and of itself for rich people and poor people? Because it seems like the middle income is the great political stabilizer that's either getting lost in the developed economies or not growing fast enough in developing economies.
So it really is his question that is at the conundrum. I mean, it is a conundrum because, Brian, you're raising the point that certain people, when we talk about inequality, feel that they don't want to engage because it means that they have to give something up. Maybe they need to give something up. So the question is, though, politically, that may not work. So in your cities, how do you deal with this question that Brian has put to us? Please.
Yo tengo un ejemplo que quiero.
I have an example that I like to share. Our city decided on a purpose which was to recover biodiversity. In other words, eliminate the antagonism between city and nature. I mentioned this already, but we have a plan for it. And the plan is built on a narrative which is logical, and which is beautiful at the same time. And therefore, it has been well accepted. And that narrative is basically to give better and more habitats to tropical bees, to hummingbirds, and to butterflies. We call that Sweet City, Sweet Ciudad Dulce in Spanish. And basically, this is an article that articulates the agenda of inclusion for the city. So when we include biodiversity in the city, when we recuperate original biodiversity in a country that claims to be a champion of conservationism of nature, what we are doing is to break down that double morality that population has with regard to what it means to be a conservationist, because up to now, the idea is to conserve that which is far, not that which is near, and rather in the immediate environment to eliminate any vestige of nature. But that takes us to a bunch of situations of inequality, in inequity, because basically, the double standards, moral double standards, produce inequality. And when we cure the double moral standards, we are also generating participation, because participation is effective. And it's effective along all the groups of population. And so successively, this project has purposes with regard to poverty, in regard to access to nature that I spoke about, which is an incredible paradox, impressive, and maybe the hardest symbol of inequality in our countries, where everything grows easily. It turns out that access to nature is a privilege of class, to which poor populations don't have an access. In other words, poor urban neighborhoods are not only depressed, but also arid, in such a way that a project like this, with a narrative like this, we can try to work with many topics that have to do with inclusivity or inclusion, and allows us to base ourselves on this idea of a good narrative. Tenemos tiempo para una última.
Charlotte Aldrich from the Royal Society of Arts. Earlier we heard three things that were mentioned as how we could create a more inclusive economy and inclusive society. And the first was addressing lack of access to public services and government decision making. Then there was about something about the economic and social infrastructure that allows people and places to thrive. And the final one was changing the economic rules that currently act against providing opportunities for all. Numbers one and two, I think, is within the gift of government to address quite relatively easily and pragmatically within the current paradigms. What about the third one, and what gift have city leaders got to address some of those economic rules? We've heard about the living wage, but I'm just curious for other innovations.
Yes, I have one example for Stockholm, that to fight social exclusion, we have also decided to establish a social investment fund. It's about $40 million in the fund, and it will be used to implement a series of preventive initiatives for long-term gains at the individual and societal level. So that is one example. We put money into to really have good practices, and it will be a long-term goal for this fund. So that's one example how we do it from Propstock.
I'll just add, in addition to the quality of life, there are many cities that are moving forward policy for family leave, making sure that that people have access to family leave when needed. Early childhood programs that are moving their way throughout the country are ways to make sure that high quality daycare is in place so families can actually go to work and not have to make the decision of do they stay home or do they go to work. And then we talked earlier about the inclusionary zoning that allows for more participation into the housing markets. So we're able to match housing with income levels.
Mm. Great. So I'd like to at this time thank this great panel of global mayors.
Thank you.
Terrific participation. And I'd like to invite the deputy mayor of Paris, Patrick Klugman, forward for a few remarks from Patrick, please. I will give the microphone to you.
Thank you, Darren. Thank you, dear president. Thank you, dear Secretary General. Je parlerai en français.
I'm going to speak in French, if you would allow me, because this is a language which I'm in charge of as a municipal authority when I speak abroad. I would like to start by directing a special message. The mayor of Paris wanted to be here, and the mayor of Brussels also wanted to be here. And this morning, the mayor of Brussels came to Paris and addressed the Council of Paris. It's the first time that a mayor elected members of our city council. At the end of his speech, he said that the response of Brussels and the response of Paris to the terrorist attacks that have shrouded our cities, like many other cities, would be that of inclusive cities. His last words was that his response as a city would be inclusiveness. And I would like to report his words, because I think it was his way, at least that's how his team conveyed it to me. It was his way of being with us this morning and to behave as a champion of inclusive cities, because the mayor of Brussels is one of our champions. A few words on Paris. I would like to thank you for the great offer that the city of Paris has offered me. It is true that this is an important step for the OECD, along with the Ford Foundation, not just on inclusive growth, but inclusive growth in cities. And it's true that cities are the space where the greatest expectations and frustrations are expressed. It's also the space and the territory where we can present solutions. This demonstration was shown during the COP21 negotiations, where we held the largest negotiations. Paris is a thriving, vulnerable city. All cities are powerful and vulnerable at the same time. We We have simulated a flood risk recently. We're also vulnerable to violence. Paris, like all great cities, must face its challenges, the challenges of vulnerability. There is no other solution than to be an inclusive city. That is our constant response. That is our political priority. Annie Hidalgo was elected by making the fight against exclusion her priority, but it's even more our priority since we were thrust into mourning twice, and you said so, Mr. Secretary General, in January and November. Our response is to avoid manufacturing people who will become radicalized and who will become terrorists. As a municipal authority, we have no police powers. We do not have intelligence. We do not have an army. And in Paris, the state sees to this. Our only mandate is to ensure that our citizens can live together and can grow together. And the events that we've had to take on, and that's why we are delighted to be part of your program, have led us to ask ourselves what type of city we were. Were we the capital city, the capital of France? Were we a city loaded down with glorious history? Were we the city of our inhabitants? Were we the city of our residents, the tourists, or people who are fleeing misery who come to see us? And our response is to be everyone's city, because that's what it means to be a worldwide city, to being a powerful city, a well-meaning city. That means being an inclusive city. I am happy to conclude and call you to a rendezvous next November 21st for a meeting of the champions of the inclusive cities. And I would like to thank you once again for the immense support that you provide to cities and for the way that you conceive our future together. Thank you.
Now we're going to see each other in Paris. That's good. It's a good place. The food's still good. We live there and it's okay. Listen, let me just leave you with a thought. Imagine that we're all going to be putting together this platform, and it's going to be like a hub of best practices, and we're all going to be telling our stories, huh? And we're going to be sharing our successes, and we're also going to be recounting our failures, nos échecs. De temps en temps, il faut le faire.
From time to time, you have to do that because
effort for the others will say, don't go in that direction. It doesn't really work that well. But then it's also going to be a place where if some of you are confronted with a particular challenge, be sure somebody else already had it, already confronted that problem, already probably solved it or did it, and therefore you can call in, and then whoever did it is going to call back, or we're all going to be chipping in saying, well, you know, this is the way. This is how you do it. Or there are seven or eight different ways of doing it. In your particular case, we would suggest it. So we're going to be, you know, helping and operating the Ford Foundation, the OECD. We're going to be supporting the teams here in order to help you make this platform a very powerful, very useful tool. It's about you, it's about your plans, it's about your programs, but as has been said here again and again and again, it's about your people. It's about the people who live in the cities. It's about more and more of our citizens that are going urban and therefore who need to resolve their day-to-day challenges. And you're going to make it possible, and our platform is going to make it hopefully a little easier to deal with all these challenges. This is why this is so exciting. Now that we have our next meeting in Paris, I understand that there's even a little bit of, elbowing to say who's going to be next after that. But it's not about just meetings. It's about what we're going to do in between. It's about how are we going to build a platform. It's going to be about how we're going to be exchanging the experiences, And it's about how we're going to be learning from each other. And it's about how we're going to be asking questions from each other. And again, it's for our citizens. So better policies for better inclusive growth, for better lives. Thank you all very much. It was great.